We shall now move to the discussion portion of this stream. So, no illustrations, unfortunately. Ba-da-ba-ba. I am kind of disappointed. Oops. When it comes to fairy tales, maybe it is a incorrect assumption of mine, but I do expect a fairy tale to have lessons or morals or a point. Not a point in terms of purely from a storytelling perspective, because Holger Danske does have a point from a storytelling perspective, which is to celebrate Denmark and this character of Holger Danske, which I do believe in the way that this is written is not made up by the writer of this story. Much like Cupid in The Saucy Boy, this comes from the culture that the writer is writing in. The amount of attention and laurels, not laurels, the amount of attention and delight with which the writer describes the lions of Denmark's flag and sings the praises of Denmark and the other Nordic countries and the characters of their history. All of this indicates to me that the writer is either from Denmark, from the Nordic countries, or he really, really appreciates them. There's another story that also talks about Nordic folklore. Mentions Nordic folklore, is around Nordic folklore, which is the one of the Alpine Hill. So there's not really any point other than to sort of write about something that the writer likes, enjoys, and is proud of, which is this Holger Danske. So he obviously likes the character, he likes the idea of this hero, mythical hero, stuck in a prison, waiting for the time when he will be needed, and then he will come to the salvation of his people and his country. That is the point of, and the point of the story is just to write somewhat from his perspective. It would be akin to me writing Odysseus returning home after the 10 years and finding his family and his house in the state that he finds it, and then I would kind of give my perspective on what it would be like. Or perhaps it would be more if I wrote from the perspective of his townspeople, so that I could portray Odysseus from a third-party perspective, which is what this man is doing. And I could go on about the marvels of Greece and what they've accomplished, their past histories. I could mention the gods and other heroes and so forth. But there wouldn't be a teachable point to the story. A story can have not teachable knowledge, which this one has. I have never heard of Holger Danske. I never heard of any of these, of the legends, of the reasons behind the flag. And it's very interesting to find out and to learn this. It's also stuff that I will forget in 10 minutes. I think most readers would forget very quickly. You either know this because you grow up in the culture and you hear these stories over and 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 over again, learn them in school and blah, 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 so you know all of them. I mean, I am Portuguese. I know a lot about Portuguese history and kind of legendary characters like this. Not a lot of folklore back south, as in south of Europe, but still a lot of legends, a lot of myths that people who are not from Portugal will not know of. And if I would explain it to you, you would maybe find it interesting, you would delight in the stories, but you would certainly not remember them, and it wouldn't change your life in any way, really. It all comes off as a mere curiosity. So what I'm saying in a very long form is that I expect classic fairy tales to have a teachable point, a moral backbone, so to speak, that it is presenting and it is trying to convince us to adopt, to convince the reader to adopt. So the fact that there is nothing here, all the other stories, even the ones I don't like, I could still see a teachable point even in the ones that I didn't, because they were too short, they were ill put together and whatnot. But there was always a teachable point, but there isn't one here, as far as I can tell. You can maybe reach and say that it's about the value of remembering tradition, remembering our story, since the old man is telling these stories and is getting his grandchildren interested in them, or trying to get them interested in them. It could reach, but I don't think there is any intention to broach that subject, the subject of keeping tradition alive and all of that jazz. The story itself is doing that. That would be the point of the story, but it is not a teachable point for us to, you know, change our perspective on things and change as people, or further confirm that we have the right way of thinking or feeling in regards to a situation, relationship, or whatnot. There's nothing about that, and I actually do have this expectation that fairy tales will very much focus on that, so I'm surprised. But maybe that expectation is wrong. That's the point, that this is, I would say, a stereotype that probably maybe might be incorrect and wrong and unfair to hold of a story that is described as fairy tale. I mean, the person who wrote this wasn't writing a classic fairy tale, they were just writing a short story about Holger Danske. In terms of a lyrical analysis, I can point out that I didn't like the switch to present tense that happens here, because it begins in the past tense. Does it begin in past tense actually? And has quite the appearance. Oh, it actually doesn't, but it is by far the most. Okay, it doesn't begin in the past tense. It begins in the present tense, and then there's a tense switch to a past tense. So it begins in the present, I'm sorry. The story begins in the present tense and then switches to the past tense here. And it is kind of a context switch that I don't much appreciate. But that might be also a product of my generation, or our generation of storytelling, in which everything is very POV, is very point of view driven, very personal point of view driven. We nowadays, the vying styles, the more successful styles, the more popular styles are, well, Game of Thrones, you probably know about this one. But even if you read something like Harry Potter or anything, most stories of our generation are being written in a personal point of view. But in this time, writers would actually switch about, even as early as the 50s, and I would even stretch into the 80s, writers, successful mainstream writers, were still using a different approach to storytelling. They were actually in the place of someone who was talking to us, instead of trying to get us in the mind of a specific character, because there was more of a point of telling a story and carrying a point than there was putting us in the character's shoes and reaching out to us to try and basically try and make that point that they want to pass emerge out of our own compassion for the character that we are reading. When I mean compassion, I don't mean compassion in the strict meaning of the word, as in our ability to understand empathy, I guess, would be the more correct. You'll understand if I use empathy. So our empathy with the character will then emerge the point that the writer is trying to carry forth. Well, that would be the theory, but mostly a personal point of view is simply used because it grabs our attention better. It keeps our interest a lot more effectively because it is easier to get a reader invested into a character if you use that kind of technique. So you see nothing but nowadays. But in this day, you know, when you think about the other classic fairy tales that you might know, Red Riding Hood and all of those, they're always told there's no point of view, there's this character did this and they thought this and they talked this and they said this and they thought this and then this other character thought this and said this. And as I said, you can find this style of writing until very recently, but at the turn of the millennium. Now, I would say that in the 90s, we were already that style of storytelling was already disappearing from mainstream and even any kind of successful writing. Anyway, I don't appreciate the 10 switch here. I think it kind of comes out of nowhere and it does take me out of the story because I feel like this whole portion doesn't belong to the story. It's just the writer describing pretty things from his own point of view. There's no storytelling going on here. And then he just starts storytelling with the 10 switch. And I personally don't appreciate that. I like my stories to be stories from start to finish. I don't like this for these kind of fourth wall approaches. So I don't feel very great about this story. I think it's fine. I'll personally wouldn't be interested in reading it again, ever again. Hopefully the flying trunk would be better. That will be the next story, the next one that we shall read. For today, that will be all as far as the reading and the discussion is concerned. I hope that you found my thoughts interesting. I went a little bit more on technicalities of writing and storytelling than usual because there was so very little to analyze in terms of the story itself. It's very cut and dry, everything, all the metaphors, all the comparisons, all the analogies, they're very obvious what the writer is doing. I really don't feel the need. If you don't understand, then you don't understand. I don't know. I really believe you do, whoever you are. No matter your age, if you pay attention to what is written there, to what I read or to what you read, then I think there's nothing for me to explain other than what little I did. And then I talked about writing, about storytelling, about perspectives, and about strategies. So I hope that was interesting. Thank you for listening. Let us all have a very nice evening. Take care and see you next time. This is Cuscopia signing out.